Welcome everyone. This is Mamta Sharma from iChar Support Foundation, and I'm delighted to bring to you yet another episode of True Talks, a special interview series where we discuss various themes to understand self and life. We have with us to answer our questions Nitin Shah, founder and director of iChar and iChar Support Foundation. Welcome, Nitin, to this episode.
Thank you, Mamta. How are you?
I am good, and I hope everyone else is too. Welcome everyone to the 14th episode here. Today we are going to focus on parenting, from controlling to nurturing. If you have any questions, suggestions, please leave them in the comments below. We'll answer them as we go along. And you can also start a watch party on your account so that your friends and connections can also benefit from this discussion today. So Nitin, I'm sure everyone is really excited and interested in what we have to share today in parenting.
Yes, Mamta. So, but before we start discussing about parenting, yes, I have a couple of questions for you. Remember in one of the last videos, you spoke about the book that has been created by the government of India on the first 1,000 days?
Yes, Journey of the First 1,000.
Correct. So would you be able to give us a brief introduction? Because I think that probably would be a good place for us to start.
All right. So the book, The Journey of the First 1,000 Days, we created it for the Ministry of Health. It was created for everyone, primarily for parents-to-be and parents who have very young babies, children. The book basically focuses on how the child's development starts, not at birth, not when they're conceived, but as early as when the parents start thinking, the couple starts thinking about having a child, you know, when the first thought is kind of planted in their mind that they should start a family, have a child, and so on. Okay. And why so much emphasis on those early 1,000 days? Because, you know, let's look at it like when the child is born, or when the, not even born, even before that. The brain and the nervous system, think of them as, you know, wiring in a house. So a house has been constructed, which is the body, and the wiring, which is, let's say, the nervous system, the brain, the spinal cord, has been laid. But the connections will start forming when interaction starts happening between the child and the people and the world around the child. Right?
Fair enough.
And for example, you know, we say, the book says that the child's proximity to the mother is very important in strengthening those connections. And as many as of the new connections will be formed, the better the cognitive and mental health of the child will be. So for example, you know, I'll just share something very interesting with you, that when the mother kisses the child, any germs, any pathogens on the child's body travel through saliva to the mother's body. The mother's body recognizes them as pathogens or foreign matter and creates antibodies for those germs or those microorganisms. Those antibodies are then sent to the child via the mother's milk. And that is one of the reasons why breastfeeding is so important. So, you know, this is how important those first few days are, in fact, the first 1,000 days can be, beginning from even before the child is conceived, right? So the entire book is like a manual, you know, like a guidebook for parents to be and young, new parents, right? And this is, you know, all this knowledge is not really something that is new. We have been, we have stories around it. Say, for example, the story of Abhimanyu from Mahabharat, who, you know, gained the knowledge of how to of strategic warfare when he was in the mother's womb, when Arjun was narrating the story to his wife. Now you also have concepts like hypnobirthing, where, you know, the mother is given hypnotic suggestions so that she goes through a very smooth, very natural, and a very effortless labor. So all these concepts have always been there. The book has kind of brought it all together along with the best practices and the latest breakthrough research, so that, you know, it's all there in one place for parents who want to know about this and who want to raise not only physically, but also cognitively, mentally healthy children. who also grow up to be cognitively, mentally healthy adults.
Brilliant. Right. So that seems to be a very, very good idea to work on a book like that. And I'm kind of glad that the government decided to take the initiative and work on a book like that.
Yes.
Right? So where is it available?
Okay. So the PDF is available online for free on the Ministry of Health's website. And I'm sure for everyone who's watching, we can always share a link in the comments. And you can just press the link, download the book and read it and keep it with you for, you know, even reference later or share it with other people.
Brilliant. So, and with what you have shared with respect to the idea that even from the time that the parents conceive the idea of the child, since then the child's development starts getting influenced by the thoughts and the emotions of the parents.
Oh, yes.
So that tells us the importance of mental health even before the child is born, as far as the child is concerned when it comes to parents.
Right. Remember the other day you were mentioning how if the mother is in fight or flight mode, can actually affect the child later?
Yeah.
So,
I remember.
So all that influences, you know, the parents' state of mind. In what state of mind is the child conceived? What is happening around? We used to have, you know, these things which have again started coming up, like garbh sanskar. The mother should listen to good literature, read good literature, listen to good music. There should be a general, overall happy environment in the house.
Yeah, and that's exactly what now hypnobirthing also talks about, where the idea is that before the child is born, you have to help the mother remain in a positive state, help the mother learn how the entire process can be painless.
Correct.
Right.
Absolutely.
Brilliant.
Absolutely.
So I would really recommend that book for everyone who is interested in parenting, and also especially if you're about to become a parent, or if someone in your family is about to become a parent, probably that book is something that you should keep in mind, simply because it literally becomes like a manual that you can refer to for the first 1,000 days. Am I correct, Mamta?
Perfect. That's the idea.
Brilliant. Now that we have spoken about the book, right? Let's quickly talk about what happens when the child is born. So in the first 2 years, what according to you are the key challenges that the parents are facing?
All right. So Nitin, initially from my own experience as a parent as well, you know, initially, let's say the first year and a half, or, you know, the first year and a half, there's literally, you know, children don't come with a manual. Okay. And they cannot communicate. They do try to communicate in their own ways, but we don't understand. We are not capable of understanding that kind of communication, really. Till we actually, you know, keenly observe the child and start looking for patterns and then know what the child is trying to communicate. So the absence of verbal communication, and especially first-time parents have no idea what to do. Almost no idea what to do, right? So there's a lot of pressure on the parents. Obviously, they want to do everything right by the child. Every parent wants to be the best parent ever. Plus, things like the child does not have a routine. So the parent may not be able to even sleep properly. And something as simple as not being able to sleep means your entire next day is gone for a toss. Yet, you have to care for the child, meet the child's demand, because the child is completely and utterly dependent on the parent, you know. So obviously there's a lot of frustration, there's a lot of pressure, there's a lot of physical exhaustion as well, right? So all those are like primary challenges that parents have during that time.
Okay, and as a result of all this frustration, irritation, what happens? How does that influence the parents, especially when it comes to parenting?
So obviously they, you know, tend to make, should I call them errors or mistakes, you know, here and there, that they wouldn't have made if they had somebody guiding them, you know, as I said, there is no manual, you know, or if they were somehow better able to manage their day, manage their life, then they wouldn't make, they would be better equipped to care for the child and care for themselves.
Ah, brilliant. So, which means that while we are talking about parenting and parenting skills, and obviously learning to be able to observe the child and understand what the child may mean, what the child is trying to communicate through their crying and through different styles of crying that the child may have, eventually it does come down to the parent's ability of being able to manage their emotions and their mental state, especially in the first 1.5 years. Would that be fair to say?
Oh yes. That is actually what they need more than anything else.
Ah, brilliant. So that's one part of the story, which means that even from the time the child is born, parents have to learn to take care of their thoughts and emotions. And we've already spoken about how to take care of our thoughts and emotions, haven't we?
Oh yes. I remember that.
So for the reference of all those people who are watching right now and who may not have followed our earlier episode, we actually covered a complete video, a complete episode on managing your thoughts and emotions. It was, if I'm not wrong, the third episode in this series. If you have not watched it, I would really recommend watch it, because it will be useful to you not only as a parent, but also in every other walk of life.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Now, while we are talking about parents, obviously the child in this age, 0 to 1.5, is considered to be in the age of infancy, right? As per the stages of psychosocial development.
Yes.
And as you mentioned earlier, the child is completely dependent on the parents. So, predominantly, the child is living on that hope that whatever they require would be provided to them when it's needed by them.
Yes.
And what happens if the child does not get what they're looking for in this age, or if there are unnecessary delays, or if the child feels that they are in need and there is no one around them, then what would happen?
Then I guess they would develop a sense of mistrust, you know. There would be no trust that my caregiver, will they be around? Am I safe? You know, those kind of questions.
So even the stages of development basically talks about this, right? That between in this age group, the crisis that the child is going through is stressed and mistrust. And if the child feels unsafe, unsecured, or if the child feels that they don't get what they want, then they have a tendency to develop a sense of mistrust.
Right.
And hence it becomes like very, very important for someone to accompany the child as far as possible all the time, at least in the first 6 months, 1 year.
Right.
And ideally that person who needs to be available is the primary caretaker, the mother in most cases.
Yes. True.
Perfect. So, and that's also one of the things that we keep telling people, that, you know, when you're with your kids during this age group, this trust and mistrust can play a very important role. Many a times mothers delay going back to the child, right? Have you noticed how the child is crying and the mother is cooking food at times? And I'm sure you've experienced this, and you know people around you. And the mother decides to wait for 10 minutes before going to the child. But for the child doesn't know that the mother is going to come after 10 minutes.
Correct.
And when the mother is not there for the 10 minutes, for the child, it could literally mean that my survival is at stake.
Correct. True. Yes.
Right. And that's the reason why it's a good idea that their needs initially needs to be met during this period. Second, there are also places where we have a tendency to kind of snatch away things from the child.
Right.
Have you noticed how there are places where the child will pick up something which is like sharp, and then the mother or the father runs towards them and snatches it away from them?
Correct.
Now, put yourself in the position of the child and tell me what happens to the child.
Yeah, obviously, I will be very untrusting. You know, it would be like, oh, they keep taking everything away from me. Because that is what we do, right? Almost everything. They can't pick up anything from the floor. They can't. So anything which is in their reach is either fragile, either sharp, hot. You know, everything has that potential of causing harm. And we keep snatching it away, right?
Correct. And that's probably not a very good idea, right?
But then, Nitin, what do parents do? Because as I said, I've been a parent. How do you ensure safety? That is also of utmost importance, isn't it?
It is. But then if you know that you want the child to be safe, and if you also know that the child picking up a sharp object will be dangerous for the child, what was the sharp object doing there in the first place? Matlab, then that's us as parents who need to ensure that those things are out of the child's reach, aren't they?
Right.
And that's where baby-proofing house comes into play nowadays. And having said that, I do understand that there are places where parents may not be able to, obviously, it's kind of impossible to ensure that everything is baby-proof. Right? But then we are not saying that you can't be making a mistake even once. So this can't be happening even once. At times, it's good for the child to know that everything that they want, they may not get it. But if this happens frequently,
yes,
then obviously that's the time that it becomes a bit of a problem. Right? So between this age group for parents, 0 to 1.5, it's kind of important to ensure that the child feels safe, secure, and that you're not snatching things away from them. Interestingly, I had one of these participants who had shared a story with me. This was very interesting because she had told me that, Nitin, one day, she had just delivered a baby sometime back, and then the child was small. You know how small babies crawl, and the child picked up a sharp object. So she said, I ran towards the child, and then I remembered I'm not supposed to snatch this away from the child. So she said, so I picked up another object, which was like blunt, and I gave it to the child. You know how we play with the child, that we give something to the child and then we ask the child for the other gift in return. So she said that, you know, I kind of did that, but I gave it to the child and then I asked the child for that in return. But, and the child gave it. The problem is, after a few moments, the child gave back the blunt object and asked the mother for the sharp object again. And she played so smart. She said, because when I started realizing this, I played the game with the child for a few moments. And then I asked my maid to create some sound in the background with another toy that creates a lot of sound. You know, now kids have this tendency to get distracted. And the child literally turned around, started walking towards, started crawling towards the maid to play with the games. And the mother removed both the objects in the back end. So that's kind of smart, that if something like this happens, you should also be able to find a way to be able to work around it.
Correct, correct. And I think that would need the parent to remain calm, and which brings us back to thoughts and emotions again.
Correct. So that presence of mind on part of parents may be very important.
Makes sense. Yes.
So this was 1 to 1.5 years. Again, Mamta, from your point of view, between 1.5 to 3 years, what are the key challenges that the parents face in the early childhood?
Okay, so now, now it's time to set like a routine for the child, because they're no longer infants. So they're learning to walk and all that. So then parents' primary challenges are toilet training. A lot of children turn into fussy eaters around this time. And this, we have talked about this in the book, that there comes a time when almost every child will become a fussy eater. But what most parents try to deal with it is they start force feeding the kid. So plus some kids start going to, you know, the first school ever, like the play school or the preschool that we call it now. And at the same time, parents also have their own, you know, kind of peer pressure, where other parents around them are sharing how their kid started walking at such and such age. Oh, achha, your kid is not walking yet. My kid eats all green vegetables. Does your kid do the same? So there's a lot of mental pressure again. So apart from what you're trying to do with your child, the world is telling you what is ideal. Because, oh my God, what if you're not able to do it right now? And, you know, it'll be bad forever. The child will, you know, so someone's kid is sucking on their thumb. How it is going to ruin their complete, you know, facial structure, and how it is bad. So parents are under tremendous pressure. Plus, then there is also this thing now that, you know, I should groom my child in a way that they turn out to be best in all aspects. So that has already begun while the child is still really young.
And with all these challenges that the parents are facing, again, what would be the key element for them to be able to manage this?
Yeah, so let's take, the example of, say, bedwetting, right? Mm-hmm. While doctors keep telling parents, and I've witnessed this personally, that it's okay if your child is bedwetting still, it will go, you know, it will change with age. And there are logical things that you can do. So make sure that any liquids that your child is supposed to drink, it stops 2 hours before or 1.5 hours before bedtime, so that they do not need to, you know, visit the washroom at night and so on, right? Apart from that, the parent also needs to, you know, kind of recognize things like, is the child scared of going to, of visiting the washroom at night? Or are they looking for attention in some way? Because the day they bed wet, the parent pays a lot of attention over what has happened, and there is a whole discussion around it and analysis around it, right? Remember, as you spoke about positive intention, right?
Yeah.
So that could be at work there. So it's not. Plus, another very interesting thing that we do as parents is to sometimes push our own agenda. We willfully scare the child.
Yeah.
You know, khana kha lo, nahi to chowkidar aake le jayega, billi aa jayegi, kutta aa jayega. You know, and this is a lot of times that we are actually planting. You know, in one of our discussions, you've said that most of our fears are learned. And this is the time when they're learning most of their fears. So initially we tell them, you know, let's say a dog is a very scary thing. And 2 years later, we are telling them, nahi, nahi, kuch nahi hota. Let's pass through the street where the dog is not going to bite you. Not recognizing the role that we have played in creating that fear in the first place. So I think we need to be cognizant of those facts and check our own behavior.
Okay. So it'd be fair to say that us checking our own behaviors, being able to understand the child better, and again managing our own thoughts, emotions more effectively, would probably be the best things that the parents can do for themselves.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
And when you say understanding the child, basically, if I understand you correctly, you're saying that the parents need to be able to, because now is between this age, 1.5 to 3 years, the child is beginning to understand. So the parents also need to be able to put themselves in the child's shoes and understand what the child is going through, right?
Yes.
And maybe
yes.
Even talk to the child and understand what's happening with the child.
Absolutely. And children would, unless, you know, we kind of snub them and stop them, in their own ways, they will communicate, because in this, at least they can communicate in some way, you know, whatever broken language or whatever they try to, whatever way they try to communicate, they can tell you if you have that patience and that calm demeanor at that point of time, that the child does not get scared and can talk to you.
Correct. And also, this is the time when the child is kind of learning how they have an existence of their own, which is independent of their parents. So
absolutely.
Obviously, they are trying to exercise their willpower. They are trying to say no to things that they dislike. They are trying to ask for things that they really want.
Absolutely.
Right? So, as per, again, when we're talking about the psychosocial stages of development, one of the things that the stages talk about is the fact that the child is learning to develop autonomy and doubt.
Hmm.
Where
yes.
If the parents encourage the child's willpower, let the child exercise that willpower, then the child generally ends up developing more autonomy. They end up taking more responsibility for the behaviors or the choices that they make. And they also develop a stronger willpower. But if at this age, the parents stop the child from doing what the child wants to do, if the parents insist upon something that the child doesn't want to do, then obviously it also creates a sense of doubt in the mind of the child. And that doubt can become a very, very big enemy of willpower in the future.
Right. So the seeds are being sown, you know, kind of during this stage.
Correct. Brilliant.
But Nitin, at the same time, that said, you know, again, as a parent, what about discipline? Because this is also the time we want the child to, you know, start developing or at least start moving in the direction of developing good habits. So let's say food, you know, that's one of the biggest challenges. I think almost every parent who has that young a kid will be able to relate to.
So see, here's the thing, that between 1 to 3 years, isn't it true that we are getting too stuck with the idea of disciplining a child? Well, I understand disciplining, but disciplining to an extent where you take away their willpower completely, I don't think that's a very smart idea.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Second, discipline doesn't mean that you have to force a child to do something. Discipline also means that you need to be able to create boundaries, which the child will learn to respect. And for that, forcing is not as important as clearly laying down guidelines.
Correct.
Right? So especially correct. From 1.5 year on, well, one and a half year onwards, we are saying that we want to develop discipline in the child to eat food at the right time. I think as parents, we are kind of asking for a bit too much to begin with.
Right.
But let's assume that the child has started growing up a bit more and the child has started understanding what you are telling them. Then in that case, just lay down the boundaries, right? That let the child know that the food will be available at this time. Let's say in the morning at 9 o'clock, at 11 o'clock, at 1 o'clock, at 3 o'clock, at 5 o'clock, and then in the evening. And then if 9 o'clock you offer food to the child and the child says no, right? Let the child know that they will only get food at 11 and then don't give the child that food before 11. The child basically starts learning, right, that I am exercising my choice by saying no to food, but my choices also have consequences, which means I'll have to wait for 2 hours.
Correct.
Now, when you stick to this, the next day if the child is hungry, the child will ask you for food.
Correct.
Right? And I'm sure no child is going to go hungry if they really want food. Well, they can wait for a couple of hours, but it's not that they would not ask you for food for 3 days at a stretch.
Correct.
True. Right? So when the child is hungry, the child will ask you for that food. And we can then we can let the child know that, well, this is the time that the child will get that food. But I've actually noticed what really happens is in this stage, then the parents start feeling guilty. That, oh, my child did not have food at 9 o'clock, and then at 10 o'clock, the child came to me. And then how can I not feed the child? So then we're talking about discipline, right?
Right.
So discipline doesn't have to be necessarily by forcing the child. Discipline can be by establishing boundaries with the child. And I know the child is very young. So if you feel the child is very young to understand boundaries, then probably you're trying to establish discipline a bit too early.
Makes sense.
Right? And then this is also the age where parents end up feeding food to the child by showing them mobile phone screen.
Yes.
Now, at one level, we are talking about disciplining the child. And then at the second level, we are kind of creating a bigger mess by ensuring that the child is hooked onto the screen, which then means the child is not really aware of the fact that the child is eating. And then that can have its own repercussions in future. And we already discussed about this in the eating episode when we were talking about this, right?
Yes, absolutely. It's important. I think it's important to, you know, kind of, as you said, create boundaries and help them develop a sense of responsibility rather than a very strict, you know, sense of discipline. For example, you know, and now that I'm talking of responsibility, there's a very common practice in many households that, let's say, the child falls and it starts crying. And the child actually starts crying more because of the shock on the parent's face than their own physical injury or hurt or whatever. So they look, they turn around and they look at the parent's face, who's like, oh my God. And the child starts crying. Anyways, and the moment the child starts crying, the parents would, you know, either point to the floor and say, oh, it's because of, achha, iski galti hai. And they'll start literally beating the floor or ki, achha, cheeti ne maar diya, whatever it is. And not realizing that we've actually, instead of telling the child, ki, you know, there was this chair here because of which you tripped and fell, or there was some, or your toy was flying, you should keep your toys properly. We actually teach them to shift the responsibility to somebody else.
Right? Which is true.
So I think we,
and and it's important for us to not shift that responsibility. In fact, you know, when you share this right now, there is this story that comes to my mind. I think someone had told me this story that, and this is again related to parenting, where they said that there was this one particular scientist who did remarkably well in his life. And one of the journalists asked him that, what do you think is the primary reason for your success? How is it that when others give up searching for answers, you continue searching for answers? And he said, I don't really know what was the primary reason, but I keep thinking about this one incident that I had with my mother when I was a really small child. And maybe if you want, I can share that with you. So the journalist asked, yeah, I would like to know about that story, what that incident is. And then the scientist narrates that, you know, when I was a small child, once I tried to pick up a jar of water. And I was too young, so kind of the jar was heavy and it dropped from my hand and it spilled everywhere. It was either a jar of water or a jar of milk, something, and it spilled everywhere. So now generally the moment you hear the sound of something falling, right, what does parents do? What does a mother do?
They would obviously exclaim, make a big scene, rush, scold the child, obviously, and be scared whether the child is hurt. So a lot of things all at the same time.
Correct. And all of those things are eventually creating a sense of discomfort for the child, panic for the child and for the mother. Right. So interestingly, my mother did none of this. My mother came, she saw me, she saw the spilt milk, and she told me that now that you have kind of spilt it, you may as well play with it.
Yes, right.
Right? And she said, he says that she allowed me to play in that, like, spread out milk and so on. And as he said, and once I played in it, and you know how kids are, they get bored quite quickly. So once I started getting bored and I was about to crawl or somewhere, my mother came back and she told me, the thing with life is that when you have made a mistake, and if, once you have played enough with that mistake, you need to learn to clean that up. So she took me towards a place where there was a sponge and a cloth, and she asked me, which one do you want to pick up? And I pointed towards, I think, the sponge. So my mother picked up two sponges, one for herself, one for me. And she showed me how to clean that spilt milk. And she showed it to me like it was a game, like we are playing something. And he said, then because it was like a game and we were playing it, so I also played along with my mother, and both of us were able to clean it up. Right? And then my mother told me, once you have learned to clean up your mess, you need to learn to ensure that you don't make the same mistake again. So she took me to a garden, gave me the jar, filled it with water, and she asked me to walk. And I would try to walk, and then I would drop it, and then she would fill it up again with lesser water, and then I'll walk again. And he says that we did this. It was again like a game, but we played this till I was able to carry that jar from one place to another. And he says, then I was a child, so I don't think I understood it then. But today when I look back, I think that one experience left a huge imprint on my mind. That one, it's okay to make mistakes. It's not a big deal. I can enjoy the mistakes. I can play with that. And second, that once I have played with it, I need to clean it up. And I need to learn to ensure that I don't make the same mistake again in future.
Right.
Now, that's extremely important, no?
It is. It is, of course. And that's a beautiful example of, beautiful illustration of leading by example, you know. She herself got involved in the entire process of cleaning up, and which is brilliant. You know, for example, like, let's say parents tell children not to use, let's say, a certain kind of language, and, you know, to be polite and to be truthful, and how being honest is important and you cannot lie. While the children may be noticing, the parent, maybe not while interacting with the child, but with interacting with, you know, other people outside the house, on a phone call. Let's say the parent is driving and there's bad traffic and somebody cuts them in traffic, and they, you know, kind of lower their window glass and shout at that passing by vehicle, or maybe even use curse words. So the child is watching that. Now, one, the child is observing that they, they say something but do something else, right? It is also like being dishonest and lying in the child's perspective. Because you have said something, you have not followed it, it is as bad as you've lied to the child. Everything that we are telling the child not to do. And when they observe the parent doing it even once, that leaves an impression for a long, long time.
So, and because in this age, the children are learning by observation. Obviously, everything that parents are doing plays an extremely, extremely important role for the child. And then once the child learns all of these things, so the child learns to throw tantrums, the child learns to watch a screen again and again. at the end, yes. The child sees that, right? That the parents are constantly on their screen, they are constantly working on computers or on phones. So they also want the same thing. Right? But when the child learns this, and then parents complain that my child just keeps throwing tantrums and keeps watching television and watching screen. But they've eventually learned it from the parents, haven't they?
Yeah. Or somebody else in the environment, if not the parent, then probably somebody they're spending time with, right? Could be their house help, anybody. Or if they see the parent allowing that in somebody else, then that is equally, you know, bad.
True.
So I think once again, it comes to managing your own behaviors, which boils down to managing your own thoughts and needs.
Very, very true. And Mamta, someone has just asked a question saying that would it be right to be flexible in creating boundaries? For example, saying that the food would be available from 9 to 10, rather than saying that it will be available at 9 and then it will be available at 11.
I think that much can be done on an individual basis. That's not, because the child is still very young.
True.
Right? In fact, a better thing would be, see, a new practice that, you know, parents have started adopting is making it an entire ritual of feeding the child, which is, especially the children who are fussy eaters, for them, that becomes like, अब तो टॉर्चर का टाइम शुरू हो गया. नाउ दे आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट शविंग स्टफ डाउन माय इफ दे आर ऑलरेडी फसी. सो यू हैव टू बी वन ऑब्वियसली यू हैव टू बी वेरी ऑब्जर्वेंट. सो आई थिंक दैट ओल्ड प्रैक्टिस ऑफ यू नो देयर वाज नो सेपरेट मील टाइम फॉर द चाइल्ड. एवरीबॉडी यूज्ड टू ईट टुगेदर एंड दैट वुड क्रिएट क्यूरियोसिटी इन द चाइल्ड. ओ व्हाट आर दे हैविंग, लेट मी ऑल्सो ट्राई इट. देयर वाज नो सेपरेट मील फॉर द चाइल्ड एंड देयर वाज नो सेपरेट मील टाइम. So one, they not only ate, they also ate all kinds of food that was being made in the house.
Ah, very interesting.
Yeah. So yes, so you can keep that flexible, and why not sit, you know, with your plate and the child's plate or whichever way you want it to be, and let it be a ritual for the entire family. That serves a lot of other purposes as well. You know, family time, bonding time, time to talk to each other. So I think we need to, you know, bring back some of those practices.
Perfect. Brilliant. So if we were to summarize, basically, we have to, between this age, allow the child to express their will. Encourage their will. In fact, if there are certain things that they are saying they want to do, obviously keep it within boundaries. It's not that you never say no to your child. You may say no to your child if the child is asking for something which is not good for them. But this should not be happening over and over again. Correct?
Absolutely. Right. Nitin, I think there is another question here. How can we manage for siblings of different age groups, as elder child feels more attention is given to the younger one, whereas we make sure both get equal love and affection?
So Mamta, would you like to share your views on this first?
So what I would, you know, being the eldest sibling in my own family, and yes, elder siblings feel that more. See, because the needs are different in both age groups. Where the younger, and by comparison in the parents' head, so even if the elder one is, let's say, 17 and the younger one is 12. So while the elder one was 12 and the younger one was, say, 7, right? Now, even when the... So let's say the elder child is 12, the younger is 7. They're telling the elder child, you've grown up. You're the elder one. You should be able to let go. When the younger one turns 12, the elder one is 17. They're supposed to be adult. They're supposed to be understanding. They're supposed to have grown up, matured. They see that the younger one, who's 12 now, and I was being told at 12, that you should be responsible, you should be mature, you should be more giving. Now there are different set of rules, because the younger one will always remain younger by comparison.
Correct.
Right? So while parents need to, obviously you can sit and have a conversation with the elder child if the elder child is grown up enough. Two, you need to involve the elder child in the young, you can do that. So that's, I think, a brilliant idea. Involve the elder one when you're, let's say, caring for the younger one. And also teach the younger child that it is important to give space to the elder one. generally what happens is the younger are more, let's say they want to get into the elder one space, and let's say the elder one has more study oriented needs, so they need time, they need space, they need quiet, right? While the younger one is probably seeking attention, so they'll go and poke the elder sibling. The elder sibling would complain, and it suddenly goes out of control, and the parent has no idea what to do. Right? So obviously, managing your own thoughts and emotions is very important, because you need to remain calm and in charge of your emotions at all times. Involve them in each other's, make them responsible for each other's needs. So you can tell the younger one, you know, bade wale ka bhi padhne ka time hai, let's give him that time. Let's you come and play with me, for example. And you can talk to the elder one about the younger one's needs.
Perfect.
All together and have that conversation. In fact, let turn that into a ritual of sorts, which you do weekly. Right?
And that kind of makes sense also, because both for both the children, as you said, their requirements are different, their needs are different. If parents can understand that and can give each of them what their requirements are, probably that would really help the parents also take care of the children more effectively, wouldn't it?
Absolutely.
All right. And between the two kids, so another thing that I've noticed in families where there are multiple children is that because parents obviously are not able to manage themselves more effectively, they themselves are kind of hassled by all the things that are happening between the two kids, they also lose control of the situation very quickly. So that presence of mind that may be required for them to be able to handle the interaction between the two siblings.
Correct.
Is not as effective as it needs to be. And that brings us back to the parents being able to manage their thoughts and emotions.
Absolutely.
Right? And also, because one of the things that Raji has asked is that what if we are giving equal love and affection to both, but they don't feel that way? Maybe the understanding of love languages will come very handy, because you may feel that you are giving love to both the children equally, but their primary love languages may be different.
Yes. Right? In fact, and I'm sure both must be complaining that they don't feel love.
Correct. And so if you are parents who have like siblings, you have kids who are siblings, then it's an important thing for you to be able to understand them better. And all those things that we discussed in the relationship wala episode, where we spoke about suggestibility, we spoke about introvert, extrovert, we spoke about love languages, all of them are extremely important when it comes to your kids.
Yes. So Raji, we talked about all this in our love and relationships. I think that was the fourth episode. So it would be a great idea if you can go and watch that.
Perfect. So this was what? 1, 2, 3, right?
Right.
Now is the next one. So in the next age between 3 to 6, what do you think are the key challenges the parents are facing?
Bedwetting and all may still continue for some children. Fussy eating again. Many children learn to start throwing tantrums in this age. And some kids may even become aggressive, you know, with other children around them and so on. So those, I think, are like big challenges for parents during this time.
Perfect. And when we say this child is throwing fuss around and they're throwing tantrums around, again, where is the child learning that from?
People they're observing, their parents, family.
Again, we kind of come back to the fact that parents have to be very careful about their own behavior in front of the child.
Absolutely. I think that cannot be overemphasized. We can keep saying it over and over again.
And in fact, you know, just to give an example of tantrum, I had this child who was brought for a session for a therapy, and it was about throwing tantrums. And so when I sat with the child and I asked the child that what happened, what makes you throw so much of tantrums? And the child actually told me, because that gets things done. And I'm like, what do you mean by that? Because whenever my mother wants something, all she has to do is shout, shriek, jump, and my father does whatever she wants to be done.
Yes.
So that's the easiest way. Where do I go and explain them things? They don't really even understand. So it's just easiest for me to throw tantrums, just like my mother does, and then I also get my things done.
Yes, of course, that does happen. And it may all begin with the first time the child started shrieking, and the parent thought that giving them what they wanted, let's say, was the best way out. So they kind of reinforced unknowingly. Now the child knows that this behavior gets things done, as you said. Plus, Nitin, another thing is happening, at that time, that for some things, let's say we were talking about force feeding, and parents start saying things like, oh, you're my baby, won't you listen to mama, won't you listen to papa? So now, if you look at it closely, it's actually inducing guilt. Where there's no point of guilt. You can just tell the child, okay, here is your food. You don't want it, now you'll get it 2 hours later, right? But instead of that, we try to say, oh, can't you do this for mama? Can't you do this for papa? It's like we don't realize, we have actually started showing, while we keep saying these are negative emotions, bad emotions, how we plant the seeds often in the child's mind.
Correct. And during this age, especially 3 to 6, as for the psychosocial development, the development that's taking place is initiative with guilt. Right. So and the what the child is after is kind of trying to figure out the purpose of his or her life. And that purpose is not really the bigger purpose of life. It's just that they're trying to find meaning to their life. And you will notice a lot of kids in this age group will talk about they wanting to become drivers, conductors, Superman, He-Man, right? And we have a situation where parents get so hassled by it. Pagale, a driver, pata, driver doesn't earn enough money. That's a 4-year-old child, 5-year-old child. I don't really think the child cares as much for money at that age, in most cases.
Correct. They're just fascinated with some aspect of that thing.
So it becomes important that when the child is talking about those purposes, especially because of the age group that we are talking about, that the parent needs to be able to encourage the child. The parent needs to be able to tell the child, oh, you want to become a driver, you can become a driver, but you can become anything else that you want to become also, because that's when the child realizes their capabilities. If we start telling the child they don't know what is right for them, you don't even realize that you should not become a driver or a conductor, then obviously the child kind of starts doubting their own purpose. In fact, a lot of times, child starts feeling guilty about having the purpose that they have, having the objective that they have. And the example that you spoke about parents telling the child, mama loves you now, you will do this now, that kind of further induces guilt in the child. And that guilt is a double-edged sword. I've had people, even as adults, coming and telling me that, Nitin, we started feeling guilty at a very early age, and today the situation is so bad that if I spend time with my family, I feel that I'm not giving my family enough space, and I feel guilty. And if I don't spend time with them, then I feel guilty that I'm not spending enough time with my family.
Correct. Yeah, makes sense.
So in this age, it's actually a good idea not to try and induce too much of guilt in the child, and to also be able to kind of encourage the purposes the child has.
Yep.
Right? And Mamta, while we're talking about 3 to 6, someone has actually asked a question, saying that my child is 6 and she doesn't want to write. Anything that you would like to share about this?
So one is, again, trying to identify, what is it? So as it is said that there are various styles of learning, some kids may be primarily visual or auditory. So just see if the child is more interested in talking about it, and from there guide them to writing instead of turning writing into, the primary task. So, probably start, so because a lot of their, if she's 6 or he's 6, then a lot of their studies would be around stories and, all that. So if you realize that they are more talkative than writing oriented, or another sign could be that they remember things that they have heard at any point of time, that would be a sign that they're more, that auditory, that is their preferred mode of representing things in their head or communicating. So start with telling the story, narrating the story, talking about it, and, through play, start guiding them to writing instead of turning that writing itself into a Herculean task. Right? So that works for a lot of children.
Yeah, and maybe adding, converting the writing into some kind of drawing activity where the child can draw it first and can describe it, or at least get the child into the activity of using pen and paper.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes. And sometimes, please also talk to the teacher, because when the child is not able to do something, there's too much focus and attention into that task itself, ignoring everything else that the child is doing well. Right? So what aspect is suffering is already suffering. We add more to it, which makes the child's life really worse. Please realize they're only 6. And yeah, if they're already trying to make sense of a really large world, and it is already a big task for them in itself. It's everything is challenging right now. There's a teacher, there are other children, they want to play, they want to watch TV, then you are telling them padhai karni hai, then they have exams if they're in a conventional studying system, then they have to take exams. So there's so much going on, and they're only 5 or 6, right? Then there is emphasis on having good handwriting. So if, let's say, I do a piece of work and my handwriting is not bad, and instead of being appreciated for what I've written, if I'm told that, if the comment is about my bad handwriting, then I may not feel like writing at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think focus on what they're doing well, appreciate them for what they're doing well, turn the entire task into some kind of play or fun activity, and see if you can guide the child from there. And obviously, maintaining your own mental state is again very, very important.
In fact, I remember, so there's a friend of mine who has a daughter, and she had major difficulty writing. And she would say that, you want to ask me something, ask me verbally and I'll give you the answer.
Exactly.
Why do you want me to write? And the mother, the teachers, they tried so hard, they literally forced her to write, and she would just not be willing to write. And then one day, we were just sitting and discussing, because this was, I'm generally good with kids. So while I was talking to her, I asked her, what's the problem with writing? And she actually said that, you teach me in my school, writing means using paper. Paper is, in order to create paper, you kind of have to, destroy trees. So, and destroying trees is not a good idea. It's bad for environment. So if you have a question that you want to ask me verbally, I'll give you an answer. Why do you want me to waste paper for that?
Exactly. Yeah. So something as simple as just talking to the child, and when they're 5, 6, they can talk to you, they can communicate, right?
Okay.
And probably it's a good idea to sit down with a pen and paper yourself every day. You want the child to write every day. Never write in front of the child. Most of us have almost given up writing, with gadgets and everything else. Sit down with a piece of paper and pen and probably start writing, and the child will pick it up from there. So in any way, they're learning by observation.
So that's actually quite true, that again, that observation bit comes over here, that we ourselves don't write on paper and pen. We have now started using gadgets for everything, and we want children to write with paper and pen. But they obviously are not learning it, because we are not really doing it. There's no observation that they can have for that.
Absolutely. Nitin, a lot of parents ask me, for example, my child is very good at reading. So children who are good at reading tend to be good at writing, because they have a lot of words, they know how to create sentences and so on. So a lot of people used to ask me, how did you help your child develop that sense of reading? A lot of parents, I think Nitin's network is lost. Okay, so while he comes, we wait for him to join. Let me just finish what I'm saying. So a lot of parents used to ask me, yes, you're back.
Yeah.
So I was just explaining this, and they used to ask me, how have you inculcated the sense of reading, because that is really important. And almost every subject you need to express yourself, except maybe maths, where it can be done through numbers. So, and I, for some time, I did not know. I said, I don't even realize when she picked up reading and when she started, going from smaller books to bigger books and more complex reading. But then one day I realized that me and my husband, we both have a very, a chronic habit of bedtime reading. And even at the time when my kid could not understand words. She would sit with her book while we were reading and pretend that she was reading, because she knew the stories. We had narrated the stories to her. She understood the pictures. From the pictures, she would pretend. And we have no idea when she started understanding and reading sounds and words and phrases and sentences. So it was very gradual. So I think learning by observation is an amazing tool and a very simple tool that parents can use.
And going back to the fact that I was talking about communication with kids, so with this friend's daughter, the interesting thing was that the parents then eventually spoke to the daughter, because the parents realized what the daughter is saying is right. That's what you're teaching her in the school. And then you're actually asking her to go against what she has learned in the school by actually making her right.
Absolutely.
So they spoke to the child and they told the child, "Beta, what you're saying is right, but people still need to know that you have learned things clearly. They need to give you marks. And, you know, there has to be something in writing so that, you know, the other students know that teacher has not been favoring someone. So therefore, you need to write." So the daughter said that, "But then why don't you ask me to write on the computer? I can type on the laptop, right? Why do you want me to write on a piece of paper?" They had to actually tell her that we are going to look for a school for you, which will help you learn in a way in which it's conducive to what your preferences are, one. And second, that will help you not waste environment and all of those stuff. But till we find a school like that, you still need to study over here, give your exams, because only based on your exams would you get into those schools. And when the parents said this, she actually started writing in the papers.
That's brilliant. Right? That's actually a very smart way of dealing with that.
Yeah, but obviously then the parents did search for those kind of schools and put them in that school also, otherwise.
So again, parents, keep your word. What you say means a lot to them. So don't go back on your word. I think that's also another huge realization. So yes, there could be a positive intention behind the child's behavior. It could be just because of that. You know, there are, like, for example, children who would invariably fall sick during the exams. They would suddenly overnight develop fever, and the fever is real. You know, at like during one of our discussions, I think you mentioned once that if someone is very aggressive in the family, the child may develop passive aggressive behavior, right? And that could be causing this sudden sickness during the exam.
Yeah, so in fact, we actually see this very frequently in therapies, where if the child between this age, especially 3 to 6, has someone in their family who is extremely aggressive to an extent where the child gets punished or gets mistreated, even in situations where it's not the child's fault. A lot of these children end up developing what is known as passive aggressive behavior, where on the face of it, they are very passive, but there's a lot of aggression inside. And they do take their revenge in their own ways. And interestingly, they take revenge in ways that people would not even be able to figure out that they were the ones who initiated the revenge. So if you are in that situation where you have a child who's who's being mistreated or who's being abused or who's being beaten up for not having a fault of his own or her own, please take care of that. You will have to step in and protect them if the aggressor is someone else. And if you are the aggressor, please visit a therapist.
Yeah, absolutely. That's I think really important. And another thing, a key thing that we must point out here is that if there are issues in the relationship between the two parents themselves, then that is another area that you should work on if you want the child to, you know, have that environment in which they can grow up mentally, emotionally healthy.
So that environment, and again, so all of these things are tips that you can keep in mind when you're working with your kids, especially in this age group, right? This was about 3 to 6. Now, jumping to the next one, and this is a slightly bigger jump, 6 to 12, which is generally called the competency stage, where the child is trying to express their competencies, right? They're trying to establish that they are competent, that they are capable. In this age, what are the challenges the parents have?
So most challenges parents have are actually around the child's education, whether they are getting good grades, and the children may become even more aggressive they may start throwing even more tantrums. Though the earlier challenges dissolve by this time, like bedwetting and eating, because they've developed their eating preferences and so on. But other challenges take their place. So mostly around education. Another very interesting thing is the child is trying to experiment with several things. So they may say, today they may say, I want to go to a skating class. And tomorrow they want to go to a painting class. So that also may become challenging for parents. And they may also start throwing tantrums around all that.
Perfect. So obviously we have already discussed about tantrums and so on, and that a lot of that gets addressed while if the parents are taking care of their own behaviors and they are careful about what they're doing in front of the child.
Right.
Anything else that you would suggest to parents in this age group from the point of view of the challenges that you have discussed?
So again, because as I said, they're trying to experiment with several things. They're fascinated with several things, which is actually a good thing, you know. We think curiosity is one of those, a soft skill that a lot of people lack as grown-ups, because we tend to kill it when they are children. So let them experiment, right? Otherwise, how will they find out who they want to be? Because a few years later, we are going to ask them who you want to be. Around the time they're 16 or so, we are going to ask them to decide their careers. So they have to experiment while they are 10, 11, 12, you know, during those years. So, and if there is a gap between you and your child, again, sit down with them. They're grown up enough to talk to you, to express themselves to you. Create that safe environment where they can talk to you. And please listen to them. Don't expect them to take your word as the God's word. You will have to explain where you're coming from. And I think that is fair if the child asks you, right?
Yeah. So, in fact, actually, that's one of the challenges that a lot of kids share with me. That while my parents keep complaining that I don't listen to them, the reality is I've been trying to explain to them, tell them a lot of things, and they are just not willing to understand. They are just not willing to listen to me. And then if they are not willing to listen to me, then why should I listen to them?
Exactly.
Right? You know, so there's this kind of a metaphor that we use to explain this phenomena to people about talking to your kids. It's like, let's say someone tomorrow comes from an alien planet and kidnaps you. Takes you into that planet where everyone is 20 feet tall. Their style of living is very different from your style of living. Everything that's meant in that house is meant for 20 feet tall people. Well, to an extent that even if you have to go to the loo, someone has to pick you up, put you on the pot so that you can do what needs to be done. Right? How would you feel in a situation like that?
Extremely helpless. And obviously frustrated.
And that's exactly what the child feels. And now while the child is feeling that, rather than we having the patience to address that frustration, the helplessness on part of the child, we get helpless and frustrated by ourselves.
Correct.
And that obviously leads to its own problems.
Absolutely.
Right? And then imagine in that planet that you are in, because all their cultures are different. They were to ask you to do things their way without even explaining what that way is. And when you ask them to clarify why, they would tell you that because you are saying so. How would you feel again about this?
Right.
Wouldn't you like to kind of rebel against that?
Yes, while the child is supposed to explain and give fair justification for what they say, want or do, the parents generally think that they don't need to because they are parents, they know better, and that should be the ultimate explanation for anything and everything. While the parents have the best interest at heart, but there's no harm in sharing with them. So that, because that is also helping them develop an understanding of the world. It's important.
True. And then this is also the age where the child has, as I said, they are trying to express their competencies and so on. So we have parents who are comparing the child to other people around them. And that probably is the worst thing that you can do. You know when we say Sharma ji ka beta?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's a classic. Yes.
Now imagine in this age, the child is actually trying to develop the competency, is trying to show that they're competent. They want to feel confident. And if in this age you end up telling them ki Sharma ji ka beta to zyada samajhdar hai. Isn't it going to hit their confidence? And aren't they going to feel kind of a sense of inferiority?
Absolutely.
And that would become one of the primary reasons why the child will withdraw.
Yes.
And then parents come and complain ki hamara bachcha to kisi se baat hi nahi karta hai. Sehma sehma sa rehta hai. So please avoid comparing the child with other people, especially in this age group.
Yes.
Right? And I understand that as parents, we are also under a lot of pressure because obviously we want to tell people that my child is doing so well in education and exams. And I understand that we are trying to motivate the child. But you have to understand where that motivation becomes a sense of inferiority. And you need to be able to stop that if you're reaching over there.
Yes, absolutely. Makes sense.
And at the same time, I'm not asking you to go to the other extent of being a completely positive parent where you're telling the child everything that you're doing is right and there's nothing that you can do is wrong. Because obviously that has its own repercussions.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, so Yes, please.
So in this age group, being a more balanced parent where you're able to acknowledge the effort that the child is putting in, also letting the child know that they can do better is generally a better idea than either trying to be too positive or too negative.
Right. And once again, Nitin, I think we can't overemphasize, you know, managing your own thoughts and emotions, because the child is really learning that because they're dealing with peers, they're dealing with teachers, they're dealing with studies. So if you are able to maintain your own mental state, then they're also learning that by observation, that, you know, how managing their own thoughts and emotions can help them.
True. Very true. Perfect. So this was Mamta 6 to 12.
Yes.
Right. Anything else that you would like to share about this age before we go ahead in terms of tips for parents or in terms of what happens with kids?
So another important thing is, and if people who are watching can, you know, refer back to our episode where we were talking about extroverts and introverts. So there is, you know, like a new race that has come up that every child should be outgoing, outspoken, gregarious, popular, and all that. We need to understand that there is no harm in somebody who values space more than attention. Right? That is just another way of being. It is not that they lack the competence. They lack the ability. It is just that they prefer to, you know, sit back and do things from there. There are other children who want attention and who'll be, you'll find them on stage for everything. Right? But then there'd be another set who'd be probably behind the scenes coordinating things and all that. That is right. All right, because they have another set of skills. And they True. Will be able to go on stage when needed.
True. And that's right? Actually probably one of the mistakes that parents also make, that they end up confusing introverts with someone who lacks confidence. When actually the two of them are not really equatable. I mean, for example, I am fairly an introvert person, but when I am out there, I'm out there. I can, well, I personally think I have healthy confidence. And I've right. seen so and many other kids.
Right. And if you talk to those kids about things that interest them, oh, they can like have hour-long discussions with you without yeah. letting you speak, because they would have researched so much, because they generally, you know, kind of stay back. So they're more into research generally. I'm not saying, I mean, this doesn't apply to 100% of the children, True. But then they will. So when the time comes when they are interested in stuff, they will come up and take charge. Right? Okay. But somehow schools keep telling parents, oh, your child is an introvert, initiative nahi leta. If they're taking initiative in certain other things, it's all right. They may be taking initiative in organizing, let's say, the school annual day, rather than being on the stage on the annual day. It's just absolutely perfect. It's all right.
Correct. So, you know, this is what generally I end up telling parents when it comes to introvert and extrovert, that if your child is saying that they want to do something, but they are not able to, then they are seeking help, help them. Then it doesn't matter whether they're extrovert or introvert. But if they're saying that everything that they want to do, they're able to do effectively, they prefer being by themselves. But when they have to talk to people, they're also able to talk. It's not that they find it difficult to go and initiate a conversation or interact with people. Then they may be an introvert, but they don't necessarily lack confidence.
Yes. So that we need to understand those are two different things.
Perfect. So, Mamta, we then move on to the last age group that we are going to talk about today, which is like 12 to 19, adolescence versus puberty, right? Adolescence and puberty. And last age group that we are talking about today, because while parenting continues, even if your child is 45 years old, but after this age, the child no longer remains a child. The child becomes an adult. So it becomes more like a relationship conflict between two adults, right?
Right.
So between 12 to 19, what do you think are the key challenges that parents face?
So mostly within career, there are two primary, you know, focus areas. One is career and the other is children attaining puberty and adolescence. So there are two major things happening with them. They're going through a lot of changes, obviously physically and emotionally, many of them which they're not able to make sense of. So we need to have more conversations, I think, around those areas in the house. And if parents don't feel they're equipped to handle those conversations, then they probably need to seek an expert's help. The other is, you know, they're worried about career. So a lot of them will, you know, kind of start rebelling because parents may have charted their child's career in their own mind, while the child may feel differently. And that is primarily because a lot of parents are worried. They don't want their children to make the same mistakes, go through the grind. So they kind of want to turn whatever they have learned in their own life into a potion and feed it to the child.
Yeah.
So that's...
All right. And any specific tips that you would like to give to parents from the parents' point of view?
So based on my own experience and my work, with parents and children, if parents have been able to manage their own thoughts and emotions during the earlier years and have been able to bring up their child more effectively, then there are fairly lesser number of conflicts during this age. The child may rebel on smaller issues, but those will not be major issues. But if you have not been able to do that and you did not have that understanding, let us say, as parents, then you need to express clearly to the child that you're willing to understand the child. And you don't want to. They have now realized in this age that they are individuals in their own right, and they feel that we want to control them by controlling their decisions. And as a result, they feel non-understood, and as a result, they rebel. So, and another thing, when parents say we are your friends, they don't really behave like friends when, you know, children come to them or express something. They react still as parents. So please don't pretend to be friends. If you can play that role, well, good enough. If you can't, you can seek an expert's help again. And you will have to learn to manage your own if you have, you know, for lack of any other word, insecurities or concerns or worries. So in short, again, managing your own thoughts and emotions.
And in fact, so one of the things that I've noticed with parents who have been able to manage their thoughts and emotions well is the fact that the child also learns to do that at a very early age, because obviously the child is observing the parents.
Okay. Yes. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Another thing that I've noticed, so one key complaint that I've heard a lot of parents making across age groups, not only in this age group, but across age group, is that the child is not able to study, they are not able to focus and concentrate, right? And that they're scared of exams. And we keep telling the child that you need to focus and concentrate, you need to remain calm, but no one really tells them how to do that. And if obviously as parents, you don't know how to manage your thoughts and emotions, if you don't know how to be calm, if you don't know how to focus, how do you teach it to the child?
Right.
So it's again extremely important for you to be able to learn those strategies, those techniques. And once you learn them and when you're able to apply them, the child will either pick it up by observation or the child will come and ask you for help.
Right.
Right. And then you will literally be able to teach your children at a very early age how to manage their thoughts and emotions. And if there is one learning that you can give your pet, that you can give your kids, okay, that sadly not even any school gives, is their ability to manage their own thoughts and emotions. Help them learn how to do that. And obviously you can only help them learn that if you have learned how to do that.
Yeah, perfect. Makes sense.
Right.
Makes sense.
And this is again another age group where, so again, obviously this is an age where the child is, there is a lot of change that is taking place in the child. So they any which ways experience a sense of identity crisis, right? They don't know whether they are young, whether they are old, and parents go out of their way to kind of make this confusion even more elaborate and more worse.
Yes.
Okay.
Sometimes they are too young, sometimes they are too old.
Correct. So, I have had kids coming and telling me, children in this, teenagers in this age group coming and telling me, we have not been able to figure out whether we are kids or we are adults. Because I want to do something, my parents would turn around and say, you are a child. You are too young to do this. And when my parents want me to do something, they will actually tell me that you are old enough, you should be able to do this.
Hmm.
And we keep getting confused, are we old, are we young? So, and I understand from parents' point of view, because when I speak to parents, my parents, the parents are like, you know, but they are young to do certain things, they're old enough to do certain things. So we give them answers accordingly. So please just don't tell them that the child is old or young. Tell them, what do you mean by young? What do you mean by old? If you feel that the child lacks certain skills because of which you're not allowing them to do certain things. Fair enough. But inform them what skills do you want them to develop so that they can do this in future. Don't leave them at, you're too young.
Exactly.
And when you tell the child that you're old enough to do this, tell them what are the skills that they have at this age because of which they should be capable of doing this on their own. That gives them more clarity about what do you mean by old and young.
Right.
And that's when the child starts recognizing that being old and being young is more about the skills, the maturity level that they have, which will be very handy understanding to have when they grow. Otherwise, I've had people even at the age of 35, 36 telling me, I keep getting confused. Am I old enough to do this or not?
Right, right. Makes sense.
Right? So, kind of these are important things to...
Right. And Nitin, I think you spoke about, you know, how I messages can be very good in communication. So, for example, let's say my 15 or 16 year old daughter wants to travel by cab alone, but I don't feel very secure about the fact because I don't trust the cab driver. Let's take this as an example. So instead of saying no, you can't, because she can. It is not about can or cannot, right? You can tell the child, I don't feel safe. I will be worried. And then sit together and figure out a solution. Rather than, you know, kind of saying a blanket no and you have to listen to this because I'm your parent. That will not.
So, you know, when you're talking about this, I remember we were having this conversation between with a friend of mine. And she actually mentioned to me how the daughter agreed with the mother because the mother told her the mother's insecurity. So the mother actually told her, that beta, you go out in the night, you are all alone. The current situation in the world is not such that I can feel safe and secure when you're out alone. I don't know what will happen with you because while you may trust your friends, I don't know your friends very well. And then if I keep giving you a call every half an hour, every 1 hour to check on where you are, what you're doing, you get very irritated. And then we end up having a fight. So I would rather prefer you don't go out because, again, I understand you may be capable of handling yourself. But when I'm home alone, that kind of literally kills me not knowing whether you're safe or not. And it was so interesting that the daughter turned around and said, Mom, I understand that you're worried about me. You know what? Let me go out. I will call you every 1 hour and let you know that where I am.
Yes.
Now, if the mother would have told her that I will call you every hour, she wouldn't have agreed. But because the mother shared her insecurities, her challenges. And see, as a child, when your mother or your father tells you that I need help, it's very difficult for a child not to give that help. But if genuinely asking for that help.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Right. So let your kids know, if you want your children to come and seek help from you when they need help, they need to know that you are willing to seek help when you need help also.
Exactly. Perfect.
Right.
Perfect.
And please don't create additional confusion for the kids. Just to summarize, let them know what they are old for, what they are young for, and on what basis are you deciding that?
Parents often don't feel you know, they come from a place like, why do I need to justify? I am obviously the parent. But when you want the child, you'll have to, you know, it has to be balanced. It has to be both ways. It cannot be one way communication. So I think that is very important, especially when now that we are, you know, going to talk about this age group and they're almost turning adults or they have already turned adults. So I think that, because then the next crisis a lot of parents have is, that children obviously become busy with their lives and, you know, they lose that connection. But that connection started building like probably 18, 19, 20 years early, right? So we have to ensure that, it is a healthy connection and there is a two-way communication is encouraged.
Perfect. Brilliant. And so, Mamta, just before we end now, there is one last question that Madhura has asked, which is, what can be done if a teenager is very stubborn and dominating?
Mm-hmm. So, Madhura, what can be done when a teenager is very stubborn and dominating? So, I don't think they'll be stubborn and dominating in all areas. There may be one or two. So, first identify what are those areas. And if the child is old enough, has she mentioned how old the child is?
A teenager.
Teenager, then I think you can have a decent conversation. Have a conversation as you would with any other adult. You know, like person to person. Because that is one big thing. So they have discovered that they're individuals in their own right. And they want to assert it also to some extent. Let them assert it to some extent. So sit down with them, have a conversation, find out what is happening. I think that is, and don't say no to everything. You know, like we said, don't say no to everything your child picks up when they're very young, when they're babies. Similarly, don't say no to everything just because, and another thing with teenagers is, we cannot compare today's teenager to my teenage 30 years ago. Right? That is another, because in my head, that is, I still keep comparing, which is not unnatural. That's a natural process because that is what I have experienced as a child. But I still need to keep coming back to reminding myself that this is 2020. Right? If I am on my WhatsApp and Facebook all day, I'm just taking a random example, then I cannot expect the child not to have a Facebook account.
Correct.
Right? Either I should have a perfectly logical explanation why they cannot have Facebook now, or if they can have Facebook, to what extent they can interact and what all they can do there. Right? For example, my 14-year-old has an Instagram account. She loves calligraphy. Right? And one day I saw her following some calligraphy experts account. And I kind of encouraged her to start putting out her own calligraphy posts. And, you know, so I kind of diverted that curiosity and that attention into something productive and into showing her that social media can be used for that purpose. I had my own concern about her using social media, but that is how I, you know, kind of handled it.
That kind of makes a lot of sense. And also, Madhura, from the point of view of therapies and sessions that we take, I've actually noticed many a times when teenagers are being stubborn and dominating. In most cases, it's also because they feel unheard. So the idea is that if I'm not being heard, why should I hear you? And if you're going to be too stubborn with me, if you're not going to explain to me what needs to be done, why it needs to be done, then why should I listen to you? And their rebellion can at times be like a very intense rebellion, but that generally would be a result either of what's happened along the years in their age. And I understand that if something has gone wrong earlier in the earlier age groups, that doesn't mean that you can't do anything about it. But just that you will have to start building that relationship with your child now. You will have to sit with them, talk to them. If you have made mistakes earlier, let them know you're sorry for those mistakes. And when you say that, a lot of time kids turn around because they start realizing that even they are at certain places wrong. But if you were to keep trying to tell the child what they need to do, without listening to them, then the chances that they will become very stubborn, they will become very dominating is very high. Also, if this domination, this stubbornness is reaching an extent of physical abuse, where they are beating someone in the family and so on, then probably it will be important for you to seek the help of a therapist or a psychologist, take the child to someone who is neutral. I have, because I'm generally good with kids, I've had so many situations where people in my family, when they are not able to handle some of their kids and so on, they would just ask other kids to get in touch with me, not because from a therapy or a coaching point of view, because kids in general like me also. So they, when they are in touch with me in terms of the relations that we have and so on, they end up telling me a lot of things that they would not tell their parents. Right. And in each of our families, there is one such person who kids generally are more comfortable with. Find who that person is and ask that person to have a conversation with the child. You will be amazed at some of the things that the child will tell this person.
Yes, that's actually a brilliant idea, Nitin, especially, you know, for teenagers, either if they have like an uncle or an aunt or a cousin who they also look up to. And for people who have younger kids, start building that, you know, start nurturing that relationship with that one person. So, for example, your own siblings or somebody else, your parents, probably, you know, the child's grandparents. Start building that kind of backup for yourself early on, because there will be times when the child may not want to confide in parents. So, you know, and they feel more comfortable. So actually actively, you know, create that, probably ask your sibling, can you be that person for my child? And I'll be that person for your child. That is actually a great idea.
That's actually an interesting idea.
This is what I did with my kid. So I'm actually building it right now.
Super. So, and lastly, please, if the child shares something with that uncle or with that aunt, don't punish them for that. That kind of defeats the purpose.
And don't try to extract that information from that person. Let it remain between them. Trust them.
Correct. And see how you can best help the child. But you don't have to like really punish the child or try to extract that information, as Mamta put it right now.
Okay.
Right? Brilliant. So, Mamta, I think we have answered most of all the questions that have been asked. We have also covered the different things that we had to cover. Today's has been like one of the longest sessions. In fact, the longest session that we have had. The episode that we have had, right?
Yes.
Perfect. Yes. So, now that we are coming to the end of this particular episode, I hope all of you who watched the episode have found it useful, have enjoyed it. Tomorrow would be the last episode in this particular season. And that would be titled Destiny of Choice. I'm not going to really tell you what we will do in tomorrow's episode. You get in touch with us. Let us know what you would like us to cover in that episode tomorrow. I hope you enjoyed the session today and the previous sessions that we have had. If you have any questions that we have not answered, please get in touch with us. Please let us know. And we would be more than happy to answer those questions to you.
Perfect. And stay tuned for tomorrow's season finale. FB Live 5:30. Right?
Thank you.
Thank you so much, thank everyone, you for joining. Thank you, Nitin. It was a great discussion.
Thank you, Mamta. Take care.
We'll see you tomorrow 5:30.